offered by some parameter called beta, which also depends on geometry. It depends on geometry basically. Okay, depends on geometry. You just have to multiply it with beta, and this beta can be obtained by looking at various charts. So depending upon the width of the plate and the and this parameter and the length of the crack and things like that, beta can be defined. So let us take an example of a simple simple case. A wall of thickness t equal to 12 mm has a flaw of 5 mm deep. So what he has given you, the half the, this is the wall, okay, this is the wall, okay, this thickness is 12 mm, it has a flaw which is going into it, which is 5 mm deep, this is 5 mm, okay, that means, okay, this is 5 mm, okay. Determine if the wall will support a tensile load of 172 MPa. So if I am subjecting it to a far away stress field of 172 megapascals, will it fail or not is the question. So what do I have to do? It's given that the critical stress intensity factor or the fracture toughness of the material, which is this K1C, is given to be 24 megapascal square root. And of course, we have given you the formula for the stress intensity factor also. And this is nothing but that beta. This is nothing but that beta, which takes into account for the fact that the stress fields are not necessarily infinitely far away in real situations. So when you take a look at this, it's actually like this plate with 2a being the crack length, okay. So you can use this expression right here, and when you use this expression right here and you calculate the value of the sigma infinity that you can actually apply for k1 equal to k1c, you get a value of about 171 MPa only, okay. That means if you apply 172 MPa, you will basically fracture. There are different ways of solving this problem. Basically, what I'm trying to tell you is that the factor of safety that you will get in this case will be less than 1. If you just calculate K1 and you know, do K1C divided by K1, you will find that the fracture toughness is actually less than. So this is a very simple problem. You should try it out. Only when you work it out, you will be able to follow what. Now, in the next part, we will switch gears and talk about crack propagation. In the sense, right now whatever we talked about was as if the load was fixed in time, right? You are just applying some sort of a load and the crack is propagating, and we said that it failed. It was more like a static analysis of a plate which is loaded, a plate with a crack which is loaded far away from the location of the crack. Now let us take a look at another situation where you have a crack, but now this load is not constant, but it is varying with time. Okay. What you can do in this case is, obviously once it varies with time, we also have to know, we also bring in the number of cycles to failure. When we say number of cycles to failure, we are also able to say after a certain number of cycles, how much this crack has actually grown. So the expression that helps us to do that is this law called as Paris law, which says that the rate of change of the crack length with the number of cycles is equal to some constant which depends on the material parameter times delta k to the power n. A and n are material constants. Delta k is nothing but sigma infinity max times square root of pi a minus sigma infinity min into square root of pi a. This is k max, k minimum. So the difference between the two is essentially delta k. So in this case, for the simple loading condition, sigma delta sigma into square root of pi a will be equal to delta k. Now imagine this. So now, so dA divided by dN is equal to sum a times delta sigma to the power n square root of pi to the power n and a to the power 2 by n, right? I'm just substituting this over here and I get some simple expression like that. Now you see that if you want to find out, you get some expression that looks like this. 2 by n right? This is the instantaneous equation, differential equation which you need to solve in order to tell how the crack length is growing as you increase the number of cycles. So you can basically integrate on either sides. Okay, this does not depend on n at all, this n. So this basically becomes from some initial number of failures to some final number of failures, from initial crack length to final crack length, if you are able to integrate this, you will be able to you will get an expression where you will have some function of the final crack length, some minus some function of the initial crack length will be equal to this. So if you are given some sort of a initial crack length and the initial number of cycles that it took to get to that crack length, and if you are given some, you know, now I am going to subject it to so many more cycles, how much will the crack grow? Okay, you can easily find that sort of, let us not go too much deep into it. I have a couple of slides here. If you have time, you can go through it. But otherwise, I don't think fracture mechanics generally forms a part of a failure theories pertaining to in undergraduate education. So we will stop at that. And if you have any question on basic static and fatigue failure theories, I would like to answer. Nonetheless, you know, you can easily go through the derivation that I have in the slides for the crack growth, and you know, you can try to learn a little bit more than what is required of it. Thank you. So if you have any questions, I can answer them quickly on what we have been talking today. Sir, yes. Sir, yes.
This is from GCT. Yeah. While designing a propeller shaft, which factor should be given priority? We have lot of factors such as fatigue, stress concentration factor, fatigue factor. Among which we should give priority to this which?
While designing a propeller shaft, what is the question? You should give priority.
Priority to which factor?
It is a fatigue problem, right? You are supposed to give importance to the fatigue stress
concentration. The question from the student is. Hello sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, I am yes. Dr. Nataraj from yes. GCT. Sir, now yes, the question sir. From yes, the student sir. Is, see, there are, we have discussed many factors, knock sensitivity factor, fatigue stress concentration factor, then yes. There is a yes. factor for bending, factor for torsion, like that. So their question is, which should be given preference in designing any machine elements? There are, we have discussed in the classes.
See, there is no such thing as preference. The way I look at it is follows. Static loading only. Nothing is moving at all. It means the only thing that you need. Stress concentration factor. This will only depend on loading and the geometry. Okay, that is K2 can be obtained from your various charts and other things. Now, when you have moving parts, okay, then fatigue comes into picture. Okay, of course, can take a while for me to understand what type of loading that you want to look at. You have to carefully see if there is an alternating component and a mean component of stress at critical points in your component that you are designing. Okay, if it is a fatigue loading, then you have to look into the fatigue stress concentration factor, and therefore you need the knot sensitivity factor also, because only with that you can find out the fatigue stress concentration factor. So it depends on the problem. Generally, if it is static, you can forget about fatigue stress concentration factor, but if there are moving parts, you need to take a careful look and see how it needs to be done. See, for example, there is a shaft, right? The propeller might be rotating, okay, and your shaft might be stationary. It need not necessarily be vibrating like this. However, because of some eccentricity in your propeller shaft, if your shaft is now vibrating, okay, now you begin to enter into fatigue regime. The shaft is subjected to fatigue loading, right? And it's probably fully reversed, and the critical stress points are near the bearing, you know, where the shaft is actually being held in the bearing, right? So you need to look at it from that angle now.
Well, we should give consideration for the surface finish factor in the endurance when deciding the endurance life of the components.
Yes, surface finish factor is an important factor that you need to take into account when you are fixing the endurance limit. Because the endurance limit that you are using is, if you have determined it in lab conditions, then it is not the right one. You need to further reduce it in order to be safe.
Then regarding the Van Mises stresses, sir, so what is the difference between the, say, they normally students have many doubts in that there is a difference between the plane stress and the Van Mises stresses.
Difference between plane stress and Van Mises stress.
Okay. The 2D stress and okay. 3D stress, I mean.
Okay, 2D stress. Okay. 2D stress.
Yes.
See, that, when you
this
have,
can be a 2D.
So what I think the confusion is in 2D and 3D. So there is always, everything is 3D in reality. 2D is only an approximation. Suppose we talk about B. When we are talking about B, say the bending of, what stress components are you actually worried about when we are talking about the bending of B? There is a beam and it is subjected to a load like that. The stresses that you are worried about are the axial stresses that occur because of the beam bending, okay. And in addition to that, you are worried about the shear stresses on each cross section. There are only two stresses that you are actually worried about. One is sigma xx, which is acting along this is the x-axis of the beam. So the sigma xx will actually cause it to expand or contract, and tau xy, okay, tau xy are the two stresses that you are usually worried about. So now other stresses you are not really worrying about in this case. So this could be looked up, and so when you write down the stress tensor for this problem, we are looking at sigma xx, tau xy, tau yx. This is what we look at. We don't want to really look at sigma yy, which is usually not there. So this is somewhat like a 2D state of stress. However, if you are looking at more complicated loading, say for example, you have like what we drew in the first class, you have some complicated. Now this stress tensor is going to be valid at every point of the beam. Now let us take a look at this potato kind of arbitrarily shaped body, and you subject it to some load. Now if you take a particular point here, it is not necessary that it needs to have the simple form, right? The stress is now having x components, shear components, it's the stress tensor is full, meaning all the components exist. So now it becomes 3D. Okay, this is the difference between 2D and 3D stresses which get induced in bodies. So I don't know if that answered your question. But
yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you. Can we draw SN curve for a composite material? Sure. You do the experiment, do the Mohr stress and draw it. But you have to be careful that directions in which you are loading, all these things can play a very important role. So whatever we have talked about is for isotropic materials, specifically isotropic metals. So you can draw, but it might need more complicated analysis than what we have done in this. Sir, can you please recheck the equation of line once? You want me to check, is there something wrong with the line equation? Okay, I will check it, but if it is a Goodman line, it's got to be this. This is SUT, this is SE, so the equation of this line is sigma A divided by SE plus sigma m divided by SUT is equal to 1. So that, you know, let's see if it's satisfying the equation of a line. When sigma m is equal to 0, I get S sigma a is equal to SE. When sigma order any component is 0, I get sigma m is equal to SUT. So I think this equation is correct. Why is CI not susceptible to notches? CI means, okay, the factors which basically take into account the endurance, reduction of the, you're already reducing it with all these factors. So I don't think you need to reduce it further. Of course, you know, the CIs that we talked about are quite arbitrary, right? We just gave some charts which people have found out, and then you reduce it. They will be subjected to some notch effects, but I think the some of the C's that we talked about already take that into account. Then it's the same questions. Why is CI not susceptible to? Oh, see, when you say CI, okay, you meant cast iron. Okay, so I think you have taken a look at my slide, and that's the reason you're asking this question. So you're not talking about the CIs that basically reduce the endurance limit. So now cast iron, when it is made, it already contains a large number of flaws. It already contains a large number of flaws. So you, the failure strength itself is already reduced to such an extent because of the flaws that you don't need to additionally account for any extra flaws that are present in the system. So that is the reason why I think we have answered this. I don't exactly remember how many I gave, but I think for each section, say static failure theories, fatigue failure theories, together there are about 5 or 6 questions, if I'm not wrong. You can use Soderberg line, okay, but you just tell the person that you have used the Soderberg, tell the person for whom you are designing your component that you have used the Soderberg line. Generally, we don't use Soderberg line because we think Goodman line is conservative enough. Soderberg line is not yield line is Soderberg line is a little bit more conservative than Goodman line, but nonetheless, Goodman line is sufficient. Sometimes we get probably too conservative results because of using the Soderberg diagram. That is the reason I can think of. But in practice, we generally use the Goodman diagram alone. Goodman plus yield line combination. What is the question? Factor of safety should be considered for Goodman's equation. Yeah, sure. So if you have this particular expression right here, then I thought that would be clearer. But if you just use this expression, it means that anything on the line will fail, right? So you can use 1 by n, where n is a factor of safety, so which will essentially be this line right here, so that, you know, whatever you are designing based on, because now you are going to design your component, you are going to find the geometry of your component based on the Goodman line. So in that case, it's better that you use a factor of safety where n is greater than 1, in such a way that you will always be within the safe. Why we use the following 3 methods? In this class, we don't generally use all the 3 methods. I just wanted to tell you that we use generally these Goodman line, and for torsion we usually use the Gough ellipse because those are experimentally shown to be good. Which one is best, Goodman, Gerberg and Soderberg? I think Goodman is best. It's simple, right? You just need to get an estimate. You can change your you can fine tune your problem nicely by just choosing different factors of safety, right? So there is no point in using some complicated parabolic expression unless experiments have shown that, you know, those curves only fit your fatigue data, right? And if you don't know anything about the fatigue data, you know, it's better to use the Goodman line. For torsion, people have found that sigma a versus sigma m, in the sigma a versus sigma m plot, it is usually a Gough ellipse. How did we got to assume that approximate stress equal to endurance limit in the Goodman line? Stress is not equal to the endurance limit. What stress? I don't understand. In the Goodman diagram, the Goodman diagram is plotted for a certain number of cycles, like I told you. So let's take 10 power of 6 cycles. This is the mean stress. This one has to be the endurance limit. The alternating component of stress which needs to be applied when the mean stress is 0, so that it just fails. Anything below it will not cause it to fail, right? Anything above it will cause it to fail in less than 10 power of 6 cycles. In less than 10 power of 6 cycles.
Huh.
Sir, can you tell in short what is the difference between Goodman and modified Goodman line? whatever we are using now is called as the modified Goodman line. The manner in which Goodman gave it involved certain other values for the endurance limit and the ultimate strength. I don't remember which one. To take a look at Norton, there is a small paragraph where it is said what Goodman did and why we are modifying it in this way. But it is not some major modification, and you don't need to worry as to why we are not using the Goodman as opposed to the modified Goodman. Whatever we are using is sufficient and is the modified Goodman. You can take a look at Norton. The answer is getting very, the answer is given very clear. Goodman is good for this class, for the purposes of design of machine elements course. In more general scenarios, Soderberg or Gerber or Gough-Phillips or other things might be more important. That will have to be tested through an experiment to decide which is good. So universally, there is nothing good. Goodman is best because it is easy. Factor of safety should be considered for Goodman's equation when you are designing something using the Goodman. Okay, I think we have concluded the session. Thank you very much. Please try to work out some of the problems that are there in the slides at least, because the solution is also there that will help you gain some more depth into what I have been teaching. Thanks.